Oh man, editing this video is gonna be quite a work, but that's Ridgewood Bushwick Senior Citizens Council. That's actually a huge company. That's just one of their departments, Benefits Enrollment Center. And I see these scattered throughout this part of this part of Brooklyn. I wanted to point that building out this company out in particular because I actually applied and interviewed for a job there before. Not these buildings. I think I have to walk like 20 more blocks or so to get to the place that I interviewed for. Actually, that might be the first place I want to head to today. It's going to take like 30 minutes to get there, I think. It's about like 1.5 miles away. That one's a homeowner and foreclosure prevention services. So it's a really, they provide services for all kinds of anti-poverty efforts. I guess that doesn't sound that wrong. But yeah, definitely I applied to be a, what was it, site coordinator? No, what did I call it? It's such a long time. I kind of forgot what it was. I think it was kind of managing one of their, or not managing, but just kind of being an outreach worker and just being a referral guide for homeless people that comes to their shelters there. So it sounded like an amazing position. But, you know, they really shouldn't have booked me for an interview because I was totally underqualified. I really didn't have any kind of experience that I can demonstrate under the belt that I can prove that I can do this thing. I mean, I'm always willing to learn. I'm pretty sure that if they put me to it, I could have done the job. I think so. I'm confident. Who knows? Maybe if I got the job, I could have turned out to be a royal screw-up. But in any case, that's one of the, there's another one. That building is actually pretty, really nice. The brown building, Ridgewood Bushwick Senior Citizen Council, Inc. So that looks to be like kind of like the headquarters building, but it's not, because I've actually seen the one like 20 blocks away from here. There's the Ridgewood Bushwick Council building, and it looks really nice. That's the headquarters there. The building that I went to was a really humongous building, too. But the interview process was quite interesting. I think that was like one of the very first interviews I've ever had in my life. So the first thing they did was they greeted me, and the first thing they had me do was they gave me this scenario, and I had to write out what I would do as an essay form. The scenario was was too basic, so my answer was, it was pretty much like someone has come into the center asking for help, what would you do? Something like that, something basic like that. And I said, the first thing would be to investigate further, like ask the client more questions about what's going on and to really develop an understanding of what's going on and how best we can do to help the client and what the client's strengths are, figuring that out. And then of course, providing their services by appropriate referrals and blah, blah, blah. So that was how it began, and then I waited like 10 minutes after submitting the essay thing, whatever, or a short answer. Then so I was interviewed by three people, but one of the persons came up from downstairs, shook my hand, asked me in Spanish how I was, like, hola, buenos dias, como estás? And at first I didn't really catch it, because I think I should have, I don't know, if I responded in Spanish, it might have turned out pretty awful, because my Spanish knowledge is pretty horrible. But definitely I didn't realize that I was being tested on my Spanish knowledge at that time. And definitely I can't say anything about my Spanish because it's horrible. But I only know like grammatical rules. My pronunciation I think I'm starting to improve on. But that's how it began. And then the three people that I met was the director and two of the site coordinator or program managers. So very high people in the company that interviewed me, and I just felt totally overwhelmed. But the first question that I got was a really good question. It really got me excited and kicked that off. The first question was, what do you think are the causes to homelessness? And that overloaded question is just like, you know, that's like a perfect question for me. Just because, you know, that's just an easy question to me. There's so much things to say about that. So that started off really well. I think I had some bumbles here and there during that interview, but yeah, that was that was when I had really high hopes for like getting into the nonprofit world. Now I'm walking into the world of dog walking, which is definitely not nonprofit. But what I'm hoping to do, if I get this position, is to make money by being a dog walker, afford living in Brooklyn or New York City, or you know, somehow afford living. Because right now, if I don't get any source of income, I'm not gonna be able to live here. I'm probably gonna have to go back to Tennessee, live with my parents, and somehow work that out. So I'm hoping to really stay here, make a living, and as I earn money that way, I want to really become involved in kind of be a regular volunteer to some organization that I really, really like. That's what I always wanted to be, kind of a nonprofit worker that doesn't get paid. And getting a dog walker position allows me to do that. It allows me to help people without feeling like I'm making money off of their misery, which is what social workers get accused of. I don't necessarily agree with the accusation, because I mean the wages of nonprofit service workers are so low. That's why the burnout in this industry is horrible. I mean the worst burnout rate I think is in the foster care industry, where you know people retire. The average burnout rate is at age 41, which is ridiculously low. That's like retiring at 41 at that age is just horrendous. But in any case, that's what we're accused of. And so I always wanted to just provide nonprofit services without money. And so if I'm able to make a living, definitely able to do that, I will be able to meet contacts that I feel will be really important in the nonprofit world. Get, you know, and just really just, I want to lead that kind of a lifestyle for a while. You know, I want to, if I get this dog walking position, they always, no, and this isn't the first dog walking interview that I've done. The one before that I also interviewed for Pup Pals before the Ibis Play Pups. And they all ask 6 months commitment minimum. And definitely I could do that. I'm totally willing to stay at this dog walking position for year, 2 years, 3 years, whatever, if I'm able to make a living off of it and just be able to keep on my feet and pay my bills and also have time to kind of act according to my beliefs in helping others, providing nonprofit service, volunteering, and just staying on my feet. Totally, I am totally willing to go down that route. But right now, I just need to be needed. That's the thing. It's getting hired is a pretty rough process, I have to say. Maybe it's because of I'm not very presentable. I have no idea. But that's what this path has taken me to. It has taken me to walking down New York City just to see how that walk would be like. And it's really, that really says a lot about me too, because I guess I haven't done too much physical stuff. The only really physical experience I had, I guess, would be like hiking, but that's personal. So professionally, let's see, I once worked in a fast food restaurant. I'm not really sure if this counts as like a really physical labor, but it was a family operated joint called Frosty Burgers. And it's owned by it was when my dad was a pastor in California, and the family that owned it was a good friend to my dad, so I needed a job during the summer, so they hooked me up, and pretty much I worked afternoon shifts, and because it's a family-operated business, they don't have an assembly line like a McDonald's or anything, so I was pretty much the cashier, the janitor, the food preparer, and the cook, and of course, everything that needed doing, I did it. It was a really amazing experience because I just got to do everything. And I really had to be on my balls to multitask. You know, 1 minute I'm manning the cash register and talking to customers and taking their orders. The next minute I'm at the storage room of the restaurant cutting vegetables. And then the next minute I'm grilling, putting French fries into the grill and preparing French fries. And you know, it was a very, it was an experience, I had to tell you. And that, I guess, counts as a physical experience. I, that was a short-term job, though, and it was a part-time job. It wasn't like 8 hours straight working or 12 hours straight working. It was because it was family operated. They didn't have many workers. They had one of the best workers in there was like the worker they had for years, you know. But that's that. The other, I guess, physical labor I could think of is worked as a security guard. But that one is really more about staying awake and kind of patrolling the routes. I worked as a security guard for a year in different boroughs. I started out in Manhattan, really, providing security service to Citibank branches. And that was actually quite fun because in the day shift, in the night shift, because I did graveyard shifts too, in the day shift, I would stand there and the customers would kind of come to me. I don't know why, but they would come to me and ask me where to go for their banking needs. And at first, I had no idea. I've never, you know, but I learned a lot about, like, and I pretty much forgot by now, but I learned where to go for banking services, and I kind of, I guess, acted as like a client relations person, even though I'm supposed to be a security guard. So I started on in Manhattan and Citibank branches, and then I was assigned to like food grocery stores in the Bronx, because I lived in the Bronx at the time. And then eventually there was a construction site in Flushing, Queens, and it was a 2-hour commute every time that I went there. So the commute itself was grueling. But a security guard job position was pretty sweet because, you know, it's, you just sit down, take patrol routes every once in a while, and then, you know, take down reports once in a while. But for most of the time, I get to just sit there, and I took my PSP and play some games during that time. And then the company lost their contract to that construction site because majority of the security guard workers were late on time, would go out without reporting it and taking their lunch breaks for like 3 hours, so they lost the contract, which was disappointing. And, you know, that's not to say the workers are bad, because I really got to know these workers personally. That's also, like, I really like taking social work to everywhere I go. You know, the values of meeting people and learning their stories I can't say it's like a hobby of mine or anything, but it's just something I love about being alive. You know, meeting other people, learning their stories, and just communicating with them. And even though being a security guard sounds like the least likely place to encounter that, I really, really enjoyed learning the stories of these security guards, my ex-coworkers, you know. And one of the weirdest things I actually had, I guess you could call it a crush on one of the coworkers. I think she was like 26 or 27. I was 22 at the time. But she was married, had kids, so it was bad. It was bad to have this crush. She had two kids, I think, or two kids or one kid. I don't remember. I remember her name, though, but I'm not going to say it because this is going to be told throughout the world. I mean, available for view, like, throughout the world, and I don't want to, you know, confidentiality still counts, I guess, even though it shouldn't in this matter. But yeah, she was a great person, and I always look forward to, you know, just waiting out the shift, because she would come in the next shift, and before I went home, I would always have, like, a 30-minute or 40-minute conversation with her. And it was just great knowing, meeting people like that. She had a really negligent husband, which is why she was like working two jobs. That's probably why sometimes she was late to her, you know, current work. I mean, the situation that these people are in, it's not pretty, folks. It's hard. I mean, I'm really coming to encounter so many lives of, you know, as a tutor, as a security guard, I've really come to really kind of witness how people live, and most of it's not pretty. It's like the way Americans live is pretty disheartening sometimes, but in a lot of ways it's also inspiring because it shows the resilience of people. It shows how strong they are to really overcome the obstacles they could cross. And now I'm just rambling about stuff like this, but you know, so I digressed talking about my physical labor. But that's pretty much it. And canvassing, of course. I did street canvassing for 4 days. And canvassing is just street fundraising, just But it wasn't like walking. It was more like staying rooted in the ground and greeting people. One of the really cool thing about this nonprofit fundraising company that I work for, which is Grassroots Campaigns, I love their approach. I really love how they fundraise. So they usually have a team of two or four people that one person will take point at this side of the street and go face this way. The other person will face that side of the street and face that way. And what they would do is kind of just stand there and invite people in with charisma and with what we do, actually, what we would have done is to just stand there, and we don't chase people. We make it so that people come to us. That's the approach. And it worked. Surprisingly, it worked really well. I almost made it to the team because to make it to staff on observance days, which are the, you get three observance days, and in those observance days, we have to fundraise certain amount of money to get hired as one of the official staff. So the requirement is $120, I think, right? So which is a $30 or $20 monthly contribution from one of the donors. So because it's been said that the average amount of time that donors stay on a monthly contribution is 7 months. So 20 times 7 is $140. Well, never mind. So I was required to raise $140, which is not that big of a deal. It should be really easy, but I had a really difficult time just because at that time, Grassroots Campaigns also didn't have license to canvass in New York. So we were in New Jersey and Connecticut in like really harsh East Coast weather. So nobody was willing to stop. And I mean, if you have talent for the fundraising, you can still do it. There was one staff member who still raised like $400, and he was actually working with me that day. So I got really close. I raised like $110 one day. I raised $90 the other day. I was really close to making the staff, but I didn't. So that's why I only worked as 4 days as a campuser. But it was an incredible experience. I really loved. That was one of those things where I'm just getting like snippets of people's lives in like 2 minutes. You know, I get there and I say hi. People stop. Some people do. When they stop, I give my spiel about, hi, I'm a fundraiser for Grassroots Campaigns, raising money for ASPCA. This is what's going on, and this is how you can help support us, and all that spiel, and people's responses to that have been quite, you know, to me, maybe I wasn't so great at raising money because at that time it just felt like I wasn't there just to raise money. I really liked connecting to these people, also learning their stories. So probably why I would make a horrible fundraiser, but I mean, I still ended up raising some money that way. In any case, but that was quite an experience, and if this dog walking thing doesn't work out, if I don't get hired, I think I'm gonna try to apply to be a canvasser again, and probably in a different company. Just, you know, the reason I didn't apply again to another canvassing company after that was because it was winter, and like, oh my god, like suffering through that cold for 8 hours. In a single spot. We're not moving. We're staying rooted to the ground. It was freezing cold. I mean, I'm willing to endure the cold and all that. And dog walking position certainly would require me to walk, you know, all day in freezing cold weathers too. So the summer I'm not too worried about. It's the winter. I really am not good at surviving the winter. But that I'm prepared for. But in any case, that was that. And also because I just didn't like how unstable the position was, because there's quota to fill in canvassing. There's quota to fill every day, every week, pretty much. If you don't raise a certain amount of money in a given week, you're given like a warning. If you're official staff, if you're not established enough, you might get fired. But yeah, you're given like, okay, well, this week was horrible. Next week, do better. If you don't do better, then you're fired. So there's that pressure of raising a certain amount of money every week. And I was thinking about that, made me like back away from applying again. But it is a really fun job that I really enjoy doing. So if this dog walking thing doesn't work out, definitely going to apply again to canvassing. Another reason that really invites me to canvassing is because I think canvassing companies hire super quick because, you know, because they fire people super quick, they got to hire people super quick. So when I applied to grassroots campaigns, I was actually, I interviewed the very next day that I called. I got interviewed. And the very next day I started on my observance day. So in 2 days, I had my shot being hired. You know, just 2 days. I mean, normal hiring process takes so much longer. Even this dog walking position, I emailed, you know, Eba's Play Pups like 3 weeks ago, right? And I get an email response back like 5 days later. And then I email them back, email her back, and I get a response like 5 days later. And then we do an interview. And then I still have to wait. I mean, that's a pretty fast process, considering the other jobs like nonprofit organizations and businesses and stuff. But canvassing? Freaking A. I'm getting hired in 2 days? That's ridiculous. So I really can't afford to wait anymore. So if this doesn't work out, I'm definitely applying to be a canvasser. I really do hope this works out though. I really am liking the prospect of dog walking and just walking around the city like this is pretty fun.